We're turning this evening to the 19th Psalm, a psalm that has been referred to in almost every address that we have had so far, as we've considered together this wonderful theme of the Holy Scriptures, God's wonderful word to us. And that will be our meditation this evening. I'm going to read the psalm together and then reflect upon it in the time that we have together this evening. Psalm 19, let us hear God's holy word. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth his handiwork. Day unto day uttereth speech, and night unto night showeth knowledge. There is no speech nor language where their voice is not heard. Their line has gone out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. In them hath he set a tabernacle for the sun, which is as a bridegroom coming out of his chamber, and rejoiceth as a strong man to run a race. His going forth is from the end of the heaven, and his circuit unto the ends of it, and there is nothing hid from the heat thereof. And the law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, yea, than much fine gold. Sweeter also than honey and the honeycomb. Moreover, by them is thy servant warned, and in keeping of them there is great reward. Who can understand his errors? Cleanse thou me from secret fault. Keep back thy servant also from presumptuous sins. Let them not have dominion over me. And then shall I be upright, and I shall be innocent from the great transgression. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Why is it that the wonder of it all doesn't keep us marveling? It is so easy to get used to the very best of things, the most wonderful of things, and take them for granted. And this is true in virtually every sphere of life and relationships. But it's tragically true in regard to spiritual matters. There's so much that we take for granted. So much of our creed never seems to really translate into the issues of life and experience. And I suppose this is particularly true when it concerns the Scripture. We have so many Bibles. We have so many versions. Some of us have Bibles in the original languages in which God inspired those ancient authors. Some have Bibles for every occasion. I must confess, I have a Bible for every occasion. I have a Bible that I use for teaching. I have a Bible that I use for personal study, whether it be in Hebrew or Greek or in English. I have multiple copies for family worship, depending upon whether we happen to be at the table or in the den. I have a copy that I use when I go to church if I'm preaching. I take another Bible if I'm not preaching. I have waterproof copies for reading in tree stands. And that's true. And I even have multiple versions on my telephone. And given the history of the transmission of the Bible that is stained with the blood of so many who paid the ultimate sacrifice toward its dissemination, I say that's no small wonder. But it's in the Bible that God has revealed to us everything that we need to know about himself, everything that we need to know about ourselves, everything that we need to know about salvation, everything that we need to know about life. God has not left us to chance or to human imagination concerning these most vital matters. God's word is able to meet our needs, whatever those needs indeed may be. The word of God is our standard. It is our rule for faith. That is what we are to believe. It is our rule for practice, how we are to behave, what we are to do. Now that's our creed, that's our confession. But it begs the question, if that is our confession, that whatever the Bible says is true, that the Bible is our only rule for faith, for practice, if that is our creed, then the question is, what does that really look like in our experience? God is not the figment of our imagination. He's not the figment of philosophical speculation. What we know about God, who is ultimately incomprehensible, yeah, what we know about that ultimately incomprehensible God is what he chooses to reveal to us about himself. That God, the creator of the heavens and the earth, that he should bend to communicate with us, creatures, is absolutely amazing, and it should overwhelm us. We ought to be keen then to heed and to cherish every bit of this divine revelation. I say to you, there is wonder, amazing wonder in the Word of God. And Psalm 19, this text that we have seen and heard so often in this conference so far, not surprisingly, because this text, this psalm, is one of the classic texts in the Bible about the Word of God. And significantly, the psalmist puts in bold here the wonder of that communication by framing it within the general theme of communication. And communication is always a two-way thing. And the psalm suggests that communication because God speaks to us and then our responding communication to him. God's speaking to us, God's communication to us is manifold. And ours to him is to be personally submissive. So this broad theme of communication develops along three lines that I want to trace in order to affirm the title of this address this evening and to deepen our sense of reality in our souls. The wonder. The wonder of the Word. And to that end, I want simply to follow the structure of the psalmist himself. There are three parts. We're going to see something, first of all, of God's communication to us through nature, through creation. That's in the first six verses. Then we're going to see God's communication to us through his Word, through Scripture. That's 7 to 10. And then finally, something about our communication to God through prayer, verses 11 to 14. And part of the wonder of God's Word is the literary artistry. That the Bible is a literary masterpiece, does not distract in any way from the spiritual message and the spiritual intent, but rather it highlights the beauty and indeed contributes to its perspicuity, that big theological word that we heard last night that refers to the clarity of the Word of God. The inspiration of Scripture by the Holy Spirit is verbal, and by that we mean that it extends to every word. When God breathed out those words to those holy men of old, he breathed out every word. So when we speak of the verbal inspiration of Scripture, we mean that every single word breathed out by that Spirit of God. We also refer to inspiration as being plenary. Plenary is full. It's a full inspiration. extending to the spelling, to the syntax, to the structure. There's everything about this Word of God that is inspired, and as we heard in Dr. Bilkus's breakout session today, as a consequence of that inspired Word, we have a Word that is absolutely infallible, a Word that is inerrant, a Word, therefore, that in every way is authoritative. Now, this is so remarkably on the surface in Psalm 19. The poetics. That's technical jargon that I use to talk about simply the way the psalm is put together. All right, the poetics, the way the psalm is put together. And the lexemes, the words that are used, point to this threefold development that we have suggested for the psalm: God's communicating through creation, through scripture, and then our communication to God in prayer. In the first section, there's a mixed parallelism. The meter is very mixed and it's irregular. And I would submit to you that even that irregular meter and that mixed parallelism of the argument of the psalmist in these verses point to the complexity of that creation that is so vast, that creation that is so minuscule, that creation that has things that we can see, things that we can't see, so many different facets and components to this amazing creation of God. And the very structure, I say, of the psalm, inspired and breathed out by this literary master, the Holy Spirit, has so constructed a word that even in the way it's put together, not only in what it says, but in the way it's put together, suggests something of the wonder and the beauty and the magnificence of that creation. We come to the second session. Now we have the Word of God and the Scripture's special revelation. And now the structure of the psalm is completely different. The parallelism is standard and the meter is very fixed, referring even, I say, by the structure, the way it's put together, to the organization and to the logic and to the consistency of God's communication of himself to us, the divine logic of God's word. And it's referred to, we're going to see the term in the first section dealing with creation, is the heavens that declare the glory of God. Yes, there's that general term for deity. A general term for deity that speaks of his transcendence and his power and his control over all creation. But we come to now that section dealing with the word of the Lord. It's the word of the Lord. And see how your authorized version spells Lord there, right? It's all capitals. That's Jehovah. That's Yahweh. That's that covenant God. And here is this God that enters into a special and a saving relationship with his people. And here he speaks to us. He speaks to us in this wonderful word. And we come now to the final section, and the meter once again becomes irregular. As we have now the emotion, we have that emotion and that sometimes struggle that goes on in the heart as we lift our voices unto the Lord in prayer. I say, even the structure. I'm telling you, the Word of God is wonderful. It is wonderful even by the way, I say, the Holy Spirit puts it together. There is a beauty and there is a wonder in the Word. That's artistry. The very sight of it is beautiful. It's wonderful. Now, let me say something about the message. First of all, then, something about God's communication through creation. Theologians refer to God's communicating through creation as general or natural revelation. And according to the Apostle Paul, what God reveals is sufficient enough and it's clear enough to render ignorance of him both impossible and inexcusable. What Paul says in Romans, because that which may be known of God is manifested in them. For God hath showed it unto them, for the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. And there are three thoughts then from Psalm 19 that warrant Paul's very dogmatic conclusion. First, we see that this creation communication is unceasing. It is unceasing. This thought that we have in verse 1 is going to be expressed both grammatically and explicitly. Grammatically, and you'll have to forgive me, I have been already identified as the Hebrew guy, and there's some Hebrew things here that just contribute to the beauty and the wonder of what God is saying to us. Grammatically, the fact in verse 1 that both of these verbs are what we call participles. The heavens are declaring, and the firmament is showing his handiwork. Those are participles. And in the Hebrew, the participle conveys the notion of that which is perpetual. It portrays an action that is habitual, an action that is continual, an action that is unbroken. Thus, the heavens are constantly, the heavens are unceasingly declaring the glory of God. And the firmament is constantly, habitually, continually showing forth the handiwork of God. The word that is translated declare has the idea literally of counting, of enumerating. And as though the heavens are pointing out day by day, constantly, unceasingly, one by one by one by one. Look at what God has done. Look at the glory of God constantly. The word shows has the idea of informing or giving explanation. And I say from the beginning of time. From the beginning of time, there has never, therefore, been a moment. Never a moment. When the heavens or the firmament have not been engaged in this communication. Consequently, there is never been a time. And there has never, therefore, been an individual in the history of time that can claim ignorance of God. That's what Paul said, that men, therefore, are without excuse. But the opening verse not only underscores the constancy of communication, it also identifies the preachers and their message. And it does so with this synonymous parallelism where the one line repeats the thought of the other. It's kind of a semantic rhyme. Kind of a semantic rhyme. And this is again something of the wisdom and the wonder of God's Word, that there's so much of God's Word that is in poetry. And Hebrew poetry, unlike the poetry, I suppose, of any other language, certainly unlike the poetry of English, is a translatable structure. We can translate it, and by translating it, because it's not depending upon the rhyme of sound, but depending upon, if you will, the rhyme of meaning, we can retain in our English translations the same kind of structure and the same kind of beauty and the same kind of artistry that we have in the original as we see in our translation. So synonymous parallelism, where one line makes a statement and the next line repeats that statement, very often in more specific terms, but the same essential idea. The preachers then before us are the heavens and the firmament. The firmament is that expanse of sky, that space, just simply a more specific term for the heavens. But rather than limiting this communication just to the skies, I think it's best to see this as a figure of speech that we call metonymy, or more literally, or specifically, synecdoche, where a part is for the whole. So the heavens are declaring the glory of God. It's not just the heavens that are doing that, but the heavens are standing. They are being used for the entirety of God's created order. There is everything in creation. Everything in space, everything in the seas, everything that we can't begin to comprehend. You think of creation. It's so amazing. It's so amazing, right? We just learned a few weeks ago that a new planet, right, has been discovered. Been there since God created it all those years ago, and man has never seen it until now. God did that for his own glory. I remember, several years ago, seeing a documentary on a underwater submarine that had the ability to go down into the depths of the sea. It had a a camera on it and lights and unmanned, but it could go down into the sea where man had never been, and it showed this submarine going down in the deep darkness of the ocean. The light came on, and there was a world down there that was absolutely fascinating. A world down there that I found amazing, creatures that were interesting and living. And for the first time, I think that was in the 20th century, right? But for the first time in the history of mankind, we saw what was going on in the depths of that deep, dark ocean. And it struck me that that's been going on since day five. That's been going on since day five, and every day God has been seeing that, and God has been taking pleasure in that, and God has made that to his glory. Even the things that we can't see, things that are so vast, things that are so invisible to us, are all working together to declare, to count out, to enumerate one after one the glory of God. And we don't think of glory here as some mystical aura that we somehow imagine around the throne. The word glory here is something that is very objective, if you will. It's something that is impressive. One's glory are the assets that belong to that particular individual, including position, possessions, achievements, abilities, reputation, character. And all that is subsumed in God's glory, defined specifically here as his handiwork, as the work of his hand. What God does, what God has made, testifies to how amazing he is. And again, I don't want to get technical, but the structure here is just, it's so wonderful. It is so beautiful. The psalmist uses here a literary device that we call chiasm. I think I made reference to that last year in some context. But chiasm is a, it comes from the Greek word X, key, which looked like an X, right? And it's a way where when you see that literary X, the attention is drawn to the center where you have that intersection. And the structure of the psalm puts the intersection at the glory of God and his handiwork. Can't be that way in English because of the nature of translation. But in the Hebrew text, the glory of God and the work of his hands, his handiwork, are there juxtaposed, focusing attention, drawing attention on that which is the declaration, that which is the evidence of the glory of God. Here are his assets. What glory. The language is exquisite, and the message is profound. What the Apostle Paul summed up in terms of the eternal power and the Godhead that creation declares, he says that very didactically. And here the psalmist David says the same thing poetically. Verse 2 pictures creation's unceasing communication explicitly with a very pointed imagery in an uninterrupted process. One day with an effervescent excitement bubbles forth the news of the next day. Every night makes knowledge known to the next. Day unto day utter a speech, bubbles forth this information. It's almost that one day is so excited. What this one day has witnessed of the glory of God, what this one day has seen of all of the manifest demonstrations of God's glory, so excited it can't wait to tell the next day what I saw about God, day after day, night after night. From the first day and night of creation week, this communication has sounded forth. It's not surprising that Paul said that men are without excuse. But second, this creation communication is understandable. We see that in verse 3. Literally, it says, non-existence of an utterance and non-existence of words without a being heard is their voice. We have here a description of the manner of communication. The communication of this natural revelation is speechless. It's silent. It's inaudible. But it is intelligible. In other words, there are no language requirements or barriers to receiving this revelation. Because here words are not involved. People's of any and every language group receives exactly the same message. We have different language groups even represented here tonight. Whether you're from this part of the world or that part of the world, it doesn't matter. The communication of God through this natural revelation, through this creation, is speechless, and therefore nothing is lost, nothing is losable in translation. Every place on the planet bears witness and receives the witness of this word. Paul's assessment was on target, for the invisible things of him from creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made. No excuse. Third, this creation communication is universal. We see that in verses 4 to 6. And the principle stated is both direct and then it's illustrated. The psalmist directly says that their line has extended throughout all the earth, and their words to the extremities of dry land, referring to the inhabitable parts of the globe. Now, there's some dispute among interpreters as to whether this measuring line refers to a line that is used for measuring or a cord, perhaps a harp string, referring to a musical instrument that would carry sound right across the planet. Paul seems to employ the harp string image in Romans 10:18, when he says their sound went forth into all the earth. Interesting there that he takes David's description of natural revelation and applies it to special revelation, changing the context and the referent, but not the thought of the widespread dissemination. Now that raises a whole other issue, I suppose, for consideration, how the New Testament uses the Old Testament, but that's a discussion for another day. But the point is clear. Regardless of how we interpret the line, the point is clear that there is no part of this world, there is no part of this world that is untouched by this communication. And the daily operation of the sun now becomes the illustration of this universality. Nothing is hid from its glow. Nothing is hid from its heat. And the sun's east to west circuit that is described here affects the whole earth. And the sun executes that commission with radiance and strength. There's an eagerness with which the sun as a bridegroom, right? The imagery there is again beautiful. The sun as a bridegroom that comes out of his chamber is rejoicing to do what it is called to do. Ecclesiastes describes the sun as panting to perform the duty that God has assigned for it in creation. The circuit of the sun covering the entire globe. The fact that the sun is selected, perhaps itself is significant. In that day, the sun very often was the object of worship by this pagan religion and that pagan religion. But rather than being the object of worship, the sun here is set out as a happy preacher of the glory of God. Created, and it demonstrates its eager service to the God who made it. Creation is amazingly beautiful and wonderful in what it reveals about God. All creation testifies to essential truths about God that is unceasing, understandable, and universal. And so I say Paul's condemnation of the human race is absolutely justified. But since the general revelation began at creation, this is important, I think, to realize. Since general revelation began at creation, it was given first then to pre-sin man. And there is nothing, therefore, in natural revelation that communicates what fallen man needs. There is nothing in natural revelation that communicates the saving message that is so essential now for those sons of Adam that have fallen into that estate of sin and misery. Man needs a gospel. and there is no gospel in the stars. I know there have been books that have written on gospel being in the stars. You think Hebrew's tough? I would hate to have to read the stars to figure out the gospel. I remember one time I was out one evening with another, and I was so proud of myself because I was able to point out Orion's belt. I found Orion's belt, and I was so proud that I was able to find those series of stars, only to be deflated when I was corrected. No, that's the handle of the Big Dipper. All right. The point is, if I had to read the stars to figure out the gospel, I would never know the gospel. The creation was given to pre-fallen man. No revelation. Man needs a gospel. And the wonder of grace is that God has not left us without that kind of revelation. And as wonderful as natural revelation is, it puts in bold our need for a way out of condemnation. And that brings us then to the second division of the psalm, communication through Scripture. I can think of no better way to transition into the wonder of God's communication through Scripture than to cite the words of the Westminster Confession of Faith, very first paragraph. And it's not without significance that the confession here begins its whole creedal declaration with a statement concerning the Scripture, because it is the Scripture that is the foundation, that is the bedrock for every other statement that will be made in that confession. But it makes this statement that although the light of nature and the works of creation and providence do so far manifest the goodness, wisdom, and power of God as to leave man unexcusable, yet are they not sufficient to give that knowledge of God and of his will which is necessary unto salvation. Therefore it pleased the Lord at sundry times and in diverse manners to reveal himself and to declare that his will unto his church, and afterwards for the better preserving and propagating of that truth and for the more sure establishment and comfort of the church against the corruption of the flesh and the malice of Satan and of the world, to commit the same holy under writing, which maketh the Holy Scriptures to be most necessary, those former ways of God's revealing his will unto his people being now ceased. The necessity of God's special revelation. Natural revelation justifies man's condemnation. Special revelation points the way to salvation. Without and apart from this gracious word from the Lord, fallen man has no hope. For again, we've heard several times in the conference so far, Paul's statement in Romans chapter 10, that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And the wonder of this word is that God gave this saving revelation as soon as man needed it. The Garden of Eden, the first theater of God's glory, became the first church receiving God's gospel. And although special revelation began in the garden, the process of inscripturation did not begin until the Holy Spirit moved Moses to write in the middle of the 15th century. And it ended with the same Spirit moving John at the end of the first century AD. And the product of that supernatural, gracious, and wonderful process, inspiration, is the Word of God that has been providentially preserved and is our treasured possession. Our proposition tonight is that we ought to be overwhelmed with the beauty and the wonder of God's Word. Verses 7 to 9 of Psalm 19 proceed from the wonders of God's communicating through creation now to the wonders of God's communicating through His Word. And before we survey a bit this section, pay attention again to the parallel structure, the way this psalm is put together. It's wonderful. It's part of the beauty. Verses 7 and 8 are going to highlight three facts about God's Word. They're going to give us a title of the Word, followed then by a characteristic of the Word, followed then by the effect that that Word has. A title, a characteristic, and an effect, what it does. In verse 9, the pattern alters a bit by giving the title and an expanded characteristic, but then expanding upon that characteristic without indicating any particular effect, and we'll see why in due course. But we have six propositions that the psalmist gives to us that define for us, that illustrate for us what we have, the wonder that we have in this book that we call the Bible. In each instance, the attributes of the Word will declare its authority, and the ability inherent in the Word is going to reveal its power. We come first to the law. The law, that's the title of the Lord, is perfect, that's the characteristic, and the effect, it converts the soul. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The word law here is the word Torah. You've heard that word, the Torah. It's the body of instruction. This word is the most general word in the Old Testament to designate all of special revelation. I think we sometimes get hung up at times when we see the word law that we immediately define it as a legal code. But this word actually is derived from the verb which means to teach. And so the Torah, the word that is here translated as law in our Bibles, refers to that body of instruction. And it is, I say, the most general word in the Old Testament that designates, if you will, what we're calling the Bible. Encompasses everything else. So whether in legislation, whether in narrative or prophecy or poetry, God's word is designed to teach, to reveal that which otherwise we could not know. Its characteristic is that it's perfect. And the word perfect here is the idea of that which is complete, that which is whole. God's word is complete, lacking nothing. Now, obviously that does not refer to the canon as far as David was concerned from his perspective, because there was a whole lot of the canon that was yet to be written from David's perspective. But it does indicate that at least in seed form, everything that God purposed to reveal was there. Complete from that standpoint in every way. From our perspective, it is complete in every single way. The canon is complete. There's no more new revelation. I'm a cessationist. I believe that special revelation ended with the close of the New Testament canon. So we're not looking for some new revelation to come to some self-proclaimed prophet. No, I say from our perspective, the Word of God is complete in every single way. Not only that it's finished, but that God has given to us in this book everything that we need. Everything that we need for eternal life. Everything that we need for our temporal life. Everything that we need for this or that circumstance in life. God's word is complete. He teaches us and He reveals to us in this word what we know. The effect is the conversion of the soul. A couple things to note here. Unquestionably, undeniably, the Word of God is the means of grace, so essential in conversion, since faith can only come by hearing, and that hearing only by the Word of God. That certainly is the case. But the point goes beyond that and includes much more than simply or only the conversion or the regeneration of the soul. The point is that the whole body, word soul refers to the entirety of man. Man's entire being, his inside, his outside, everything that constitutes man is subsumed in this word that is translated as soul. And this word of God is able to convert the soul, convert the man, the whole man. And the word convert here is the same word that is used, for instance, in Psalm 23. In Psalm 23, he restores my soul. He restores my soul. He revitalizes. Oh, I say yes, it involves what we would think of as theological conversion, but so much more. He revitalizes. He restores. He does for the whole. The Word of God is able to address the entirety of man in every need, in every circumstance of life that may come his way. His Word. This word is all comprehensive. The message of God's revelation addresses the needs of the entire man. In Scripture, I say we have the instructions that we need for life. We need the instructions that we need for death. So this first line, in many ways, this first line, the law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul, includes every specific statement now that is going to follow in the proposition after it. But we'll consider them here one by one. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The testimony. The word testimony refers to the self-attestations. What we know of God, therefore, is not relative theory. What we know of God is not make-believe. God is not the figment of our imagination. What we know of God is what he has chosen to reveal about himself, and we stand in wonder. We stand in wonder when we consider what God has chosen to reveal. A personal God. A personal God who's the creator and sustainer of all, the redeemer of his elect, the judge of unrepentant sinners. And how much more? His self-attestation, what God reveals. What God witnesses to us about himself is sure. It's reliable. The word sure means reliable or dependable. Whatever God says is true. It's a word that cannot be destroyed, a word that cannot be proven wrong. It's worthy of belief. It is trustworthy. And the effect of this reliable and dependable and trustworthy self-witness of God is that it makes wise the simple. We've heard that several times. It makes wise the simple. It supplies our basic needs. There's nothing that the simpleton needs more than wisdom. So God gives him wisdom. But there's a principle here that I want us to see that goes beyond just what God does for the simpleton. If you're a simpleton here tonight, God's word can give you wisdom. But I say the principle goes far beyond that, the implications. I think it is teaching us that whatever our need may be, there is something in God's word that can address and does address that particular need. For those that sorrow, there's comfort. For those that sin, there's a rebuke and a warning. For the wayward, there is direction. Again, I say the point is that whatever we need, we can find the answers for that in the Word of God. That's the foundation for my particular rubric in counseling. We joke about it sometimes, but here's the biblical foundation for my rubric for biblical counseling. Read your Bible and get over it. Read your Bible and get over it. More details, yes. I appreciate all that Dr. Murray does. But he constantly comes back to the Bible. Coming back to the Bible. The Bible gives to us the answers that we need. Whatever our needs are. We can come to this book and open this book with the desire of our heart before God, teach me, Lord, from your law what I need, and God speaks to us and God reveals to us in this wonderful book what we need. Statutes. The statutes of the Lord are right. The word statutes could be translated here as precepts or procedures. That comes from a word that has the root meaning of to inspect or to examine. And thus it refers to God's word as that which is revealed from the vantage point of his omniscience. The point is that God does not have to investigate in order to discover something, but the idea is that God has revealed to us the product of divine thought. That he has considered all that we need to know about him, all that we must know about ourselves. And God knows everything. God knows all that is knowable. He knows everything simultaneously. He knows everything microscopically. He knows everything macroscopically. He knows everything at once. God's knowledge is absolutely complete. It's omniscient. And it is by that omniscience, it is from that God who knows the end from the beginning, who knows the creatures that he has made. It is from that God who knows everything that he has chosen to reveal to us what he has revealed. That's important for us to remember that what we have here is not just a divine oversight. He has spoken to us on purpose with the full knowledge of our needs. There's not one wasted word. There's not one wasted word in the Bible. Now that ought to stop us short. That ought to stop us short when we come to those passages in Scripture that we tend to gloss over. Let me read this verse. This is 1 Chronicles 26, 18. At Parpar westward, four at the causeway, and two at Parpar. I'm going to ask for a show of hands. Is that anyone's life verse? No. You read that, what's the use? What does that mean? That's part of the inspired, infallible, inerrant Word of God. Parpar westward, and two at the causeway at Parpar. God revealed it. Why? We skip over that. But I say every time we come to passages like that that seem to be without purpose for us, it ought to cause us to stop short of all the things. I find myself asking this question to myself many times. Of all the things that God could have said, why did he say that? Of all that he could have said, why did he say that? God wants us to think. God wants us to think. Again, we thought last night of the clarity of Scripture and the fact that there are different interpretations at times, and indeed there are. If everything in the Bible we could understand the first time we read it, if it was so crystal clear from beginning to end and every word and every, we understood it, what would happen? You say, that was interesting. Now, let's go to something more challenging. Give me something more challenging. No, God gives us enough to think about. God wants us to think, and God wants us to slow down, and God wants us to ask ourselves the question, what in the world is Parpar? What's a causeway? How does that relate? What's the message of all the things that God could have said? What he has revealed to us, what he has given to us in this word, is the product of that divine omniscience. He has investigated our need, as it were. He has revealed to us precisely what it is that we need. Now, this statute of the Lord is said to be straight. It's referring to the right path to take. And certainly without God's word, we would be irretrievably lost. The way points to life and safety clearly marked. And the consequence is that God's word rejoices the heart. It rejoices the heart. the heart being the entirety of the inner man, if the soul refers to the entirety of man, then the heart in the Old Testament refers to the entirety of inner man, the way we think and the way we feel and the decisions that we make. The heart is the entirety of the inner man. And this word of God has the effect, it has the effect of rejoicing the heart. Rejoicing the heart. For the heart to find contentment, and the idea here of rejoicing is to be content. What is it? Where are we going to find contentment in this life? When we look at the stuff of life and the circumstances of life, there's so many things that will bring discontentment. But if we want to have contentment and satisfaction, this real, true, biblical joy in life, we're going to find it in God's Word. We're going to find it in God's Word. God's Word tells us that if we delight ourselves in the Lord, if we delight ourselves in the Lord, then we will find the desire of our heart. He'll give us the desire of our heart. Don't use that as some means of getting something here and something there. I've heard people do that. Well, delight in the Lord, give God first place, and then we can get what we want. No. Delight yourself in the Lord, and He will give you the desires of your heart. If we are delighting in the Lord, what is the desire of our heart? It is the Lord. And God will not disappoint His people. He won't disappoint His people. If we find our contentment in the Lord, if we find our contentment, if our contentment is truly in the Lord, then we find in God's Word that which is going to bring us to that joy. God will not disappoint His people when they seek their joy and contentment in Him. Then we come to the commandment. Verse 8, the commandment. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. This means that God's Word consists of authoritative declarations, not suggestions, not options, commands. He means what He says. And it's imperative that we get the point. Too often we hear what we want to hear, but discerning what He meant is absolutely crucial. His is a living Word. It's a living book. It's a living book. It's a living book, but it does not have a floating message. The message of this book is not floating from generation to generation or from circumstance to circumstance. Application, but not meaning. His intention must determine what our response is. I'm keenly aware of the hermeneutical debate that pits the author's intent against the reader's response. And so many popular Bible study groups simply go around the room sharing. What did you get out of that? What did you get out of that? What did you get out? What did you get out of that? I don't want to be misunderstood in my bluntness, but it doesn't really matter what you got out of it. If it's not what God intended, the book has an objective message. The message is not floating. Oh, there's going to be a personal resonation, and the Spirit of God is going to apply the Word to our heart, yes. But we must be seeking what God said and what God meant and what God intended. This Word is objective. Even some Christians misunderstand. The word pure, it's pure. It means clear, it's bright, it's radiant. It shines light in the path. It gives the clear directions to follow. And this, in part, addresses that clearness of Scripture, that perspicuity of Scripture. But I say even some Christians are attracted to a Jewish Kabbalism, with all of its hidden and embedded messages, as though that somehow becomes evidence of supernatural revelation. Bible study often becomes then a game of alphabetic Sudoku rather than a serious contemplation of what God meant. The wonder of Scripture is that it's divine revelation. It's not a puzzle. The Bible is not filled with hidden codes designed to conceal the divine, but rather it's revelation to communicate that will to us. And again, I've seen Christians that get enamored with this. They read something in the paper, some article of this hidden code in the Bible, right? If you count every letter backward four times, there's Hitler's name or something, you see. No, the Bible's not a puzzle. It's not a puzzle. It's revelation. It is God communicating to us, not hiding from us. It's God's communicating His Word to us. Oh, granted, there are some things that are easier to understand than others, and that's fine. But there is a message for all to comprehend, whether the layman or whether the scholar. And again, we heard that in the first address last night. And that's one of the remarkable wonders. One of the remarkable wonders of God's Word. There's something about the Word that makes it impossible for the scholar to scale the heights of it, to reach the depths of it. Yet it's sublimely clear, so that the layman, with the illuminating help of the Holy Spirit, can understand. And it's significant then that this bright and shining word enlightens the eyes. The eyes, the symbol of understanding, giving discernment, putting everything in its proper perspective. Verse 9, the fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. What a title for the Bible, the fear of the Lord. At first glance, it doesn't appear to be a title at all. But we must remember that this is poetry, and there's more to poetry than meets the eye. We must be sensitive to figurative language, which is so common to this genre. And the word fear here is a figure of speech called metonymy. Metonymy is the use of one word for another because of some association between those two words. You may read the news, and it made a statement something like what the White House said today. Well, you know what that means. It's not that that building said anything, but the building there stands for the president, so the president said something. That's metonymy, where one word stands for another because of some association between those two words. And very often there's going to be a cause and effect connection. Remember when Elisha was there dealing with his companions, and it was dinner time, and they were cooking supper, and they put something in the pot that didn't belong, and they were getting sick, and they told the prophet, there's death in the pot. There's death in the pot. Now, what was in the pot? Death wasn't in the pot, but there was something in the pot, some herb, whatever, that was causing the sickness, causing the death. So death was standing then for what caused that death to come, that sickness to come. That's the relationship here. The fear of the Lord. It is the Word of God that reveals God, that produces fear. And so the word fear then is standing for the word itself that produces and causes, that generates that fear in the heart of man. To know God as He reveals Himself to us is to fear Him. You can't know God as He reveals Himself without that fear of God. So the fear stands, I say, as a title for the Word of God itself. God's Word causes or produces the fear. In Scripture, God allows Himself to be known. And to know God, I say, is to produce that fear. The fear of God is that awareness of God that generates the awe in the heart and obedience in the walk. It affects both our worship and affects our ethics, how we behave, what we believe, what we do. And the format of the psalm shifts here at this point. Rather than stating a characteristic of the word and its effect, now we have an expansion of the characteristic. perhaps because the effect is already tied up, perhaps, in the word fear itself. The first characteristic is that it's clean. The fear of the Lord is clean. It's refined. It's free from any impurities, free from any defects. It's infallible. It endures forever. That's the second characteristic. It's eternally settled in heaven. It's imperishable. This implies as well that the relevance of the Word of God is timeless. It's universal. And that's one of the wonders of this book. One of the wonders of this book, how is it that a book that was written thousands and thousands of years ago now, how can that book that is so old have a relevant message to us? How can something so old really never grow old? It never ages. That's the wonder of this word. The judgments, the sixth proposition. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. Judgments, the record of God's decisions. The Bible is a case book of the divine will. A case book sets the precedence for determining what proper actions are in various situations, circumstances. The Bible, therefore, is to be consulted. The Bible is to be consulted, therefore, in making decisions of life. They're true, they're completely righteous, describing the decisions as perfect. They conform to, they declare the Lord's absolute standards of what is right, both in terms of doctrine and in terms of duty. It's imperative that we take heed to what God says. David ends this section expressing his wonder over what he possessed. The conclusion that God's word is more desirable than gold, symbol of wealth, or honey, a symbol of pleasure. That's logically appropriate. The word of God is that invaluable. The word of God, the Bible that we possess, is that invaluable treasure. It ought to be that sweet dessert for our soul. David certainly did not take the word of God for granted. It was wonderfully special to him. For so many hundreds of years, the Bible was a rare commodity. But for us, the Bible is a common possession. But although it's a common possession, there's nothing that we possess, of greater value. It has uncommon worth. Let us be careful not just to count or display our Bibles. Oh, I like seeing Bible verses on the refrigerator. I like seeing Bible verses on plaques, but let us not fall into the Pharisaical notion of the phylactery, not knowing, caring what's there, but just we carry it around. Now let's make it a treasured possession. A treasured possession of uncommon worth. Diligent to hear it. Faithful to read it. To heed it. All that God has spoken. And that brings us finally to the third division, the communication through prayer. Communication is a two-way exchange. In people-to-people conversation, for one person to ignore the other and turn away without response would be regarded as rude, to say the least. But to ignore God's communication to us is more than a social contravention. It's a spiritual transgression. As God speaks to us, we are to listen carefully. We are to respond appropriately. The application demanded by the word is always personal. As wonderful as God speaking to us is, perhaps the greater wonder is that God listens to us speaking to him. He's a God that loves to hear and to answer prayer. And verses 11 to 14 here demonstrate the link between God's word and prayer. And there is always a link between God's word and prayer, means of grace that God has given to us. Prayer should always flow from the word of God. The Scripture is a guide to know what to pray for. The Scripture is that which fuels our faith and belief in prayer. In the light of God's Word, David acknowledged that there were benefits for obeying God's Word, and he admitted the inherent pitfalls within himself that would hinder that desired compliance. Consequently, he prayed specifically for two things. He prayed, first of all, for personal purity, and he prayed for pleasing behavior before the Lord. And that's the pattern that we ought to learn to follow as well. We learn the pattern for our praying from that which God has revealed to us. In praying for personal purity, he first asked for forgiveness. Cleanse thou me from secret faults. Verb cleanse has the idea of acquitting or being declared free from punishment. David recognized the gravity of his crimes against the Lord, even those that were unknown to anybody else except himself and God. He knew that there could be no way forward until he had the assurance of that pardoning grace. But there was a way forward because God's amazingly and wonderfully revealed word said that the Lord is good. He's ready to forgive. He's plenteous in mercy to all that call on him. He then expressed his desire to be protected and preserved from future sins, presumptuous sins, those that insolent sins that David acknowledged were so disrespectful to the holy God. And it's always the case, isn't it? It's always the case that the nearer we are to God, the more sensitive to sin we're going to be. And as David used the word of God to come and to approach the Lord and to fellowship with the Lord, he became more conscious as he came of his own sin, of his own impurity. I say the closer we are to the Lord, the more sensitive we are going to be to our own sin, our unholiness. But there's forgiveness with the Lord. And God does not shun us away, but God in his word invites his people to come. The great transgression, he says, I want to be innocent here from the great transgression. Word the is not really there, and it's just talking about great sin. Keep me from great sin, no matter what that sin is. No matter what that sin is, not identified here. But he wanted to be freed from sin that he knew would keep him from the Lord. And certainly believers know that tension, don't we? Every believer knows that tension between the desire that he has in his heart to do that which is right and to be pure and holy before the Lord, but yet the consciousness of his own imperfections and his own impurity and his own sin. A desire to be holy, but yet that nagging presence of indwelling sin. But there is a way to victory over sin that is clearly marked. And it's God's word that directs us in that way of purity. That's wonderful. The Lord has not left us to wander our way to a closer walk with him. He's mapped out the way. He's mapped out the way. He has set the course. He's revealed to us in this glorious and wonderful word how it is that we can come into his presence to enjoy fellowship with him. And David was not concerned only with avoiding sin, but also with expressing that positive dedication to the Lord in all of his activity, his communication, his thought. He wanted his life to be acceptable before Jehovah, his covenant God, before his strength, that is his rock and his redeemer. He trusted that God would always act surely, reliably, and appropriately to meet his needs. The acceptance he desires is not referring to a legal standing, but he sought to have a behavior that would be pleasing unto the Lord. And every believer, every genuine believer has within his heart a desire to do those things that are pleasing unto the Lord. And God doesn't leave us guessing. God does not leave his people guessing as to what it is that pleases him. He's given to us his word, a word that directs us in that path of righteousness, a word that directs us in that way of holiness, a word that directs us through the cross, through the blood, a way that brings us as guilty sinners to the Lord. The Bible, God's word, I say, is absolutely essential for every aspect of life, spiritual life, temporal life, eternal life. So let us stand in constant wonder that God has spoken to us. And let us resolve to live in the light of what God has revealed to us in this amazing word. It's so easy. It's so easy. It's easy for me. And I've got a job where I spend hour after hour after hour in God's word. What a joy that is. It is. What a privilege it is. But yet even then it is so possible. It is so easy to just to take it for granted, to forget that this book that I have before me, whether it's this one that I bring to a conference or the one on my desk in my office or Hebrew or Greek or whatever it is God's word, and God is speaking to me. He's speaking to me. Can we get over that? Why is it that we so easily get over the fact, the wonder and the beauty of what we have in this great treasure that we call the Bible? We confess. We confess that the Scripture is our only rule for faith, our only rule for practice. So let's live. Let's live like we really believe it. Amen. O Lord, we give our thanks to Thee for this wondrous book, this beautiful book that we have. Lord, how thankful we are that in Thy grace Thou didst condescend to reveal Thyself to us, sinful creatures. But in this book we find something of who Thou art. We learn who we are. We come face to face with our need and the consequence of our sin. We come, O Lord, to that last word that Thou hast given, Thy Son. Lord, let us take advantage of every word that Thou hast given to us. Thank Thee, Lord, for the Bible. In Jesus' name, amen.